Hi, welcome back to the Growing Up in Scientology YouTube channel. We're going to continue our series of interviews with Mike Rinder and me, Aaron Smith-Levin. This is our part four of the interview, and we're going to keep discussing the series of questions just specifically relating to, instead of covering the chronological sequence of growing up in Scientology, just discussing answers to specific questions, specific subjects, and we're going to cover a lot today. All right, so let's pick it up right where we left off. So Mike, when you were in the Sea Org, you went right into the Sea Org. You didn't spend time on non-Sea Org staff in Scientology, right?
Right.
So, and how old were you again when you joined the Sea Org?
Just turned 18.
Okay, good. And then you were in the Sea Org until, when did you, how old were you when you finally left?
52.
Okay, good. So a few minutes. Okay, so growing up in the Sea Org, growing up in Scientology, what were you, how did you grow up thinking about the value of family, the value of parents, the familial unit, familial connections, the value of having kids? When you joined the Sea Org, Sea Org members were allowed to have kids.
Right.
Later on, that changed. Sea Org members were not allowed to have kids.
Right.
But how would you characterize, here's some of the bullet points that I have underneath this question. What kind of things did people say, or were you told, to minimize the importance of, or the allegiance to one's family? What were the reasons why you could not or should not or didn't need to go to family holidays or gatherings? What were the reasons why having kids was not important in the Sea Org, or why having kids was not as important as being in the Sea Org? What were some of the reasons why it was okay to disconnect from family members? What were some of the reasons why parent and child relationships were not actually real? You know, things like this. I mean, those are a lot of leading bullet points. But just to give you an idea of what kind of things I was hoping to discuss on this one. So, to summarize all that, but those are my bullet points. I don't want to put words into your mouth, right?
You just did.
Well, no. So, how were you raised to think about the value of the family unit? Let's kind of start with that.
I have two answers to this question. One, prior to joining the Sea Org, and two, post joining the Sea Org.
Okay.
Prior to joining the Sea Org, my family was extremely important. We were very, very close. Partly, I guess, that comes about because of the stigma of being involved in Scientology. So you tend to be, you kind of have this circle the wagons mentality, and the first wagon circle is your immediate family because they're also a part of the, the stigmatized group. It changed pretty radically when I joined the Sea Org, and at that point, the concept that nothing was more important than the purpose of accomplishing the aims of Scientology or clearing the planet or whatever the kind of catchphrase was at the moment, took precedence over everything. And that meant precedence over even spending time to write a letter to your family, let alone going away to visit them or making a trip or doing something that involved even more time than, sitting and scratching out a letter for 15 minutes or making a phone call. I mean, I say letter because when I was first in the Sea Org, I was on the Apollo, so there was no phone calls. It was only, the only potential communication was letters. And it became gradually less and less important and significant to me to maintain a relationship with my family. It wasn't that I ever disconnected from them or felt like I didn't appreciate them for what they had done when I was growing up, but now they were somewhat in the category of dilettantes because they weren't in the Sea Org. Mm-hmm. And then I had two children in the Sea Org in the early, mid-70s, and they were treated like, and I treated them like, They were, I'm not sure what exactly what the right word is. It's not just they were thetans in little bodies, but they were treated like if there was any distraction from your ability to perform your functions in the position that you held, then that then becomes a big problem. Like it's not just an annoyance, it becomes like an ethics problem.
Mm-hmm.
Your 2D is distracting you.
The 2D being the second dynamic, which means family.
From your ability to perform your duties.
Okay.
So those, my son and daughter were both raised in Scientology nurseries with nannies that looked after them basically full time. I spent very little time with them, and my wife spent very little time with them. I mean, in the early years, we would see them every day for an hour, maybe 2 hours, because it was over dinner, and then an hour for family time.
Mm-hmm.
And back in the early days when there was still time off, we would then spend, you know, like every other Sunday with them and Saturday mornings. But as time went on, that the amount of available time to devote to your children became less and less, to the point where eventually the concept of, quote, family time was canceled, and the idea of having children in the Sea Org was canceled.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, I believe that that canceling children in the Sea Org is a good thing. I don't, you know, a lot of people make a big deal about that. I think that it was actually way more humane to forbid people to have children if they were in the Sea Org than to have children raised the way that they were raised.
Sure.
And, you know, you can go off and not be in the Sea Org and have kids if that was what you wanted to do. And I know that that may come across as the sort of hardened, I don't care about kids. It's actually the exact opposite. Like, I have we both have young children now, and they're the most important thing in my life, and I derive more joy from that than anything else in my existence. But I wouldn't want them to now be raised as my two elder children were raised in the Sea Org.
Right.
And I don't think that any kid should be raised that way.
Right. I mean, the real damage came from the Sea Org members who already had kids, and then this idea was sort of introduced of, nope, that's not important anymore. And then the kids are in the Sea Org and the parents are in the Sea Org and you never see them anymore, and now they're being raised somewhere they didn't choose to be without the presence of their parents.
Yeah, my son was sent from the Int Ranch to Flag here when he was 12. No, when he was 11. Because the Int Ranch, Miscavige decided that the children of the people who were at Int, that were on a ranch, you know, a few miles down the road, were now a distraction and a hindrance to production, and they should just all be gotten rid of. So some of them were sent to LA and some of them were sent to Flag. And my son happened to be sent to Flag. And I basically didn't see him again.
Mm.
I mean, I saw him when I came to do events.
Mm.
And that was it.
So, just for some people who might not have had these words defined for them previously. So, INT is International Management, which is located right near Hemet, California. And that is, so when you had your kids, you were at INT?
No, when I had my daughter, we were here in Clearwater. She was born here in Clearwater. And then we moved to Los Angeles, and my son was born in Los Angeles.
Okay, and then and at then, some point, when you went to International Management, your kids went with you.
Yeah, they went to the International Ranch.
And so...
In fact, my son Benjamin was the first child to ever go to the Int base, because he went there a week after he was born.
Right.
And was in a room with me and my wife at the time, and a nanny, and because it was so important that I not miss whatever it was that was happening at the time, I don't even remember, that I had to be brought to the Int base. And that my son had to come with me, and there were no other kids there.
So at this time, the specific time that you're talking about when you first go to Int, you've got two kids with you and your wife. I just want to get the layout. I want to get all the details clear in my head. So at this time, international management is located on a large piece of land behind a fence. At this time, fence, no fence, it doesn't
Not really
matter.
Not really a fence.
But where you guys lived wasn't actually on the base. It was in a, I don't know, some hotels or motels away, or an apartment complex a few miles down the road?
No, at the time I lived on the base.
And you lived with your family though? Okay.
I did.
So when you mentioned the ranch, with the
ranch? Except my daughter was actually, I mean, this is so complicated. My daughter wasn't there. She was still in Los Angeles, at the nursery in Los Angeles, being looked after by the nanny. Mm-hmm. And she was five or six, I guess.
So my question here, I just wanted to clarify the issue of the ranch being located separately from international management. So in the middle of the day, if you were just on your lunch break and you wanted to pop in and see your kids, you couldn't do that because the ranch wasn't located at international management. It was located somewhere else?
10 miles away, yeah.
10 miles away.
10 miles away down a through an Indian reservation and in the back of the dead end of a dirt road.
So does that mean that, like, in the morning, the kids would get on a bus and go to the ranch, and at the end of the day, the kids came back?
No, the kids lived at the ranch. They slept there.
And so that means you lived on the ranch, you slept on the ranch?
No, I lived elsewhere.
Oh.
The kids lived at the ranch.
Oh.
The parents all lived either in an apartment complex in Hammett or on the base.
Okay, so you really, even though your kids are sent to the Int ranch to be close to you because you're at international management, you literally cannot see them because they're 10 miles down the road.
That's correct. And partly it was because prior to that, the children were in Los Angeles, so the people from Int, from the Int base in Hammett, would all drive down to Los Angeles on Friday night or Saturday night or whatever to spend a day with their kids. And that was considered to be a big distraction.
Right.
So they were moved to the ranch to get them closer so that if you were needed urgently, you could be gotten from the Int ranch, which was 10 minutes away, as opposed to being called back from LA and people had to go in the bus and there was no bus and blah, 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 blah. So it was a solution kind of to that problem originally, and right. then that became itself a new problem, and so it was just disbanded.
Wow. So during that whole time, I guess it was just kind of unthinkable that the kids would ever be located within actual proximity to their parents. That was just considered too much of a distraction. That never happened. It was never even part of the plan.
Right. Not at the international base. It was different in other places.
Right.
It was different in Los Angeles. It was different in Clearwater. And
right.
You know, they had that ratty motel here, the Quality Inn, that parents used to be forced to live at, and it was, you know, like
right.
the dump.
Right. So, but even then, and that's because I have some familiarity with how the Quality Inn was set up here in Clearwater, because when I was on course here, a lot of my friends were the young Sea Org members, actually the young cadets. A cadet is just what they call a child of a Sea Org member who hasn't actually joined the Sea Org. And even though at the end of the night, the parents would go to the Quality Inn Hotel, the QI they called it, and would stay with the kids. Well, the Sea Org members are on post from 8:30 in the morning until 10:30 at night. By the time you get home, your kids are not awake.
Right.
Or if they are, they shouldn't be, because they're waking up really early in the morning.
Right.
And so even then, there was no family time. There
Correct.
Certainly was no time allocated in the schedule for this is when you're allowed to spend time with your kids.
Correct.
Right. Okay, so I guess for me, I don't have as much of an answer to this question, because I wasn't raised in the Sea Org, and I never raised any kids in the Sea Org. But what did happen was, you know, my father's never been a Scientologist, and he lived in Minnesota when I was growing up. And so before we joined staff, we would visit him and my stepmother in the summers. And, you know, we'd go up for a month every summer and spend time with him. And then we went to Flag for training. That was definitely no longer an option. And it was a miracle that we ever even, I don't know, got... During that period, we no longer even visited him once per year, as best I can recall. I can remember maybe two times that we were going to see him, whether it was for Christmas or whether it was just because it was too embarrassing that we hadn't seen him for so long. The process that we had to go through in order to get approval, as, you know, 14-year-old kids at this point probably, to leave and see my father for a few days or a week was incredible.
I know.
You've got to go on a whole checklist of steps. You've got to get I don't know what word to use when we're talking on videos like this. It's called a sec check, a security check. It's an interrogation on the e-meter where they're basically making sure that you don't have any plans to escape during your vacation. They want to make sure you're coming back. Like, looking back on it, how embarrassing is it that before any SeaOrg member goes on a vacation, the biggest concern the SeaOrg has is to make sure you're coming back.
Right.
It's so embarrassing, right? And I remember every person I would talk to, that I would have to talk to on my way out, right? By the way, the wind is blowing pretty strong. I hope the audio still works. Every person that I would have to talk to would give me like a 15 or 20 minute spiel on, well, wouldn't it be great to bring my dad to Flag instead?
Yeah.
And I'd go, oh, my dad's not a Scientologist. Oh, well, wouldn't it be great if he were? I'm a kid. I don't care if my dad's a Scientologist or not. Wouldn't he love coming here? As a kid, what are you going to say? I don't know. I'd rather go see my dad. Is that, like, you have to justify why you're taking 5, 6, 7 days out of your study schedule to go see a family member.
Yeah, I know.
And, you know, I would call my dad as often as I could. It was never a priority, but that's because, as you said, everything becomes deprioritized in comparison to the importance of what you think you're doing with Scientology. And it's funny looking back on some of the conversations, whether it's with my dad or with my grandfather, who've never been Scientologists. And, you know, they ask questions of, well, so what are you doing? What's new? Oh, just studying, just on course. Well, what do you do other than that? Well, nothing. Well, why not? Well, because we're on course. It's hard to explain why there's never anything to do but be on course, right? And then that idea sets in of, well, how do you explain it? They just don't get it. And that's okay. They don't have to get it. Or even worse, they couldn't possibly get it. I mean, right?
Yeah, that's very true.
And so it's really, I guess that sort of sums it up. Family got deprioritized just because nothing could possibly be as important as Scientology, but not because anything in Scientology specifically says family isn't important.
Right.
It's one of those things, like, especially publicly in the media, the church will always point to things L. Ron Hubbard said about the importance of family.
Yeah.
And you're like, yeah, sure, you can point to that. But on a day-to-day basis, nobody gives a shit about those quotes from L. Ron Hubbard about the importance of family.
Right.
Right. Okay. All right, let's go on to the next one. Oh, this is a good one. What were you taught to think about other religions and God? Some of the bullet points here. Does God exist? Do other religions have value? Are other religions real or valid? Can a Scientologist really also be a Christian or be Jewish, etc., and practice those religions and be a Scientologist? And also, why does the church claim that you can be a Scientologist and be an active practicing member of other religions? So let's start with just, what were you taught to believe about God and Scientology?
Not much. Okay. I mean, seriously, right. That question is sort of a, what are you taught to believe? You're taught to believe that you should figure it out for yourself.
Okay.
That's basic. That is basic. That is the fundamental teaching of Scientology. Figure it out for yourself. And the way that you will figure it out for yourself is if you do enough Scientology that you will attain an enlightened enough state that you will be able to come to your own realization about what God is or what God does or what the meaning even of the, or what even what the concept is. And there is a lot of, you know, yammer that goes on, kind of, you know, the sort of, we don't really want to say this out loud kind of stuff about, you know, is everything all just one big Thetan? Are we all little bits of some greater whole? Is there some secret thing? And, you know, I think people that haven't done the OT levels think that there is some big secrets contained in the OT levels that are going to, you know, reveal this. Like, the eighth dynamic, OT8. So therefore, on OT8, where it's truth revealed, you're going to find out all about God. And, you know, the ultimate answers to all questions or something like that. But the fact of the matter is, God is in Scientology, like a lot of the other religious trappings of Scientology, God is a bit of a joke. It's a bit of a, well, we need to have God mentioned somewhere, because how can you be a religion if there's no God at all? Mm-hmm. And, you know, there are religions that don't really have God. You know, Buddhism doesn't really have God per se, other than yourself, kind of, I guess. But to meet with or to fulfill what is considered to be a religion in, at least in, you know, Judeo-Christian society, or even whatever that word is, however you say it, Abrahamic or Abrahamic, I don't know, parts of the world, you have to have God. So Scientology has God mentioned.
Sure. But, okay, good. Now, real quick, I want to just define some terms. You mentioned the eighth dynamic. In Scientology, part of the core teachings is that you can take life and divide it up into eight units, and they call the units the dynamics. So the first unit is yourself, the second unit is family. I'm sorry, the first dynamic is self, the second dynamic is family. The third dynamic is any group. The fourth dynamic is all mankind. The fifth dynamic is plant and animal life. The sixth dynamic is the physical universe. The seventh dynamic is basically supposed to be spirits or spirituality, and the eighth dynamic is supposed to be the God dynamic. And he never says this means there is a God, but this is the portion of life that people devote to, maybe even just asking the question, is there a God? And whichever God you believe in, it falls into the eighth dynamic. So you were talking about the fact that because the eighth dynamic also happens to coincide with OT8, that maybe some people would have that idea that there's something revealed. Also, OT8 is called the truth revealed. Okay, so that's where you're going with that. Now, when you mentioned God is mentioned, within the last 15 years or so, Scientology came out with basically a big fat booklet of Sunday sermons, and churches all of a sudden started to do...
I put that together.
I knew you were going to say that. Churches all of a sudden had to start all scheduling a Sunday service right after lunch. And there's things in those sermons that use the word God. The Scientology marriage ceremony, I think, mentions the word God. But I remember, and I might be jumping ahead a bit on answering my questions here, having to sit in those Sunday services was always a little embarrassing, because here, first of all, most of the people in those Sunday services were all staff members, and we all truly understood Scientology. We weren't new public who had been bullshitted into getting into Scientology.
Right.
So we're all kind of sitting around sort of uncomfortably kind of staring at each other like, we've got to pretend to be doing this bullshit now? Like, who are we kidding? Why are we doing this? Like, we don't do Sunday service. That's not what Scientology is about. We don't do God. That's not what Scientology is about. So some of like we all sit around and had to kid each other, because David Miscavige decided that in order to make sure the IRS didn't take away the tax exemption, we had to pretend to do Sunday services for a couple of years.
That's exactly right.
That is exactly what happened, isn't it?
That's exactly what happened.
And you know what? Your normal org has probably stopped doing Sunday services.
Oh, I'm sure. Unless someone's beating on them, it's like, it's a complete waste of time.
Right.
You know, like I said, there is mention of God, you know, no agency short of God in these very, in like the creed of the church, and these things that are written for the purpose of being a grand statement.
Right.
But in the usual day-to-day run-of-the-mill activities of Scientology,
yeah,
there's no prayers. I mean, and there's even a made-up prayer, you know, the prayer for something or other. I can't even remember what it's called. You know, prayer for the good of the world or some thing that was written by someone in the Guardian's office to have a prayer. So there is a prayer that can be said at Sunday service.
Right.
I mean, that's kind of what it's about.
Right.
And as for the stuff about you can be any religion and be a Scientologist, yeah, right. That is a line that gets used to help handle scaredy cats. The people that are afraid that something of value to them is going to be taken away from them by something that they don't really know and understand yet. So they're told, it's okay, you can continue to be a Christian, you can continue to be a Jew, you can continue to be a Buddhist, you can be anything, as long as it's not a psych, and still be a Scientologist. But the truth of the matter is, as soon as you get to the first issue that is in the front of every course in Scientology, except for the introductory courses, the issue called Keeping Scientology Working, it tells you that there is no other path. There is nothing other than Scientology. Everything else is a waste of time and leading you off into the abyss of unknown unhappiness and the chasms of whatever. I mean, all the terminology it's very, very explicitly says you're either a Scientologist or you're not. You can't be anything other than a Scientologist. You can't go practice anything else. You can't get involved in doing other things and other practices than Scientology. It's Scientology to the exclusion of all else.
Right.
And then you get these guys that go around and say, well, I'm still Jewish. I'm a Jewish Scientologist. Yeah, they you know, go to Jewish delis and eat tongue sandwiches. And that's about the extent of their Judaic practice.
They might celebrate Hanukkah instead of Christmas.
Oh, it's a holiday.
Right.
It's ethnic.
Right, right.
They are ethnically Jewish or ethnically Christian because they have Christmas and they take a vacation for Easter and whatever, and that's it. They do not believe that Jesus Christ is the salvation of mankind. They believe L. Ron Hubbard is the salvation of mankind if they really are a Scientologist.
Right. So you mentioned earlier on that the official position of Scientology is figure it out for yourself. So did you, this might be a little redundant at this point, but was it apparent to you, did you get the sense that that was really just a cop-out so that they didn't have to overtly say there is no God? Or do you feel that Scientology does allow for a Scientologist to believe in the existence of a single supreme being?
Oh, boy. I think Scientology would allow someone to believe that. But the problem with that concept is that it kind of goes a bit contradictory to other fundamental concepts of Scientology, such as, you know, you are the cause of your own existence, you are responsible for all things that happen to you. You know, we were talking the other day about, you know, a leaf falls in the forest and you have a cause over the leaf falling in the forest. And it's kind of hard to square up those concepts in Scientology with the idea that there is some single supreme author of the universe who controls everything that happens because he's the creator of the universe. I mean, for me, that's an impossible it's impossible to have those two things go together.
Right.
But on the other hand, for me, it's just as impossible for the illogics of the Christian God or the Jewish God or anybody else's God to go together with what happens in the world. You know, right. I always laugh when I see the guys who come off, you know, the quarterback that comes off after just having won the game and says, thanks to God, he was on our side. Well, what about the guy on the losing side? He might be just as devout a Christian as the winning quarterback. And what does he say? It wasn't in God's plan for me today. Well,
he worked
why
in
not?
In various ways.
Anyway, I don't even want to get into that discussion or debate because it's such a touchy subject.
Right.
But honestly, I think that it is a sort of a cop-out, and I don't think that it squares the concept of a single, all-knowing, all-powerful creator of the universe squares well with the Scientological concepts of responsibility, and you create your own reactive mind, and you can gain enlightenment not by seeking to understand God, but by seeking to understand yourself.
Right.
You know, those things just don't all go together.
Right.
There's a lot of things that don't go together in Scientology.
True. So what about Reverend Alfredi Johnson? He's promoted internally in Scientology as he's a Black Baptist minister. For all Scientologists know, he's still an active Baptist minister with his own congregation. I have no idea if it's true.
Yeah, he runs it out of the World Literacy Crusade.
I know, but that's...
I'm serious.
Oh.
You go like that. He does.
But does he have a church? No, I know. But I mean a real Baptist minister with a congregation and a church. Not a tutor center in Compton that, you know, he pretends is a church. Okay.
I don't know what the difference is.
No, but let me ask you, because I think you were very active in, you know, the legal, and you must have been very active doing something with Reverend Alfredi Johnson when he was getting into Scientology, and, you know, he's gone clear. He's the one that got Louis Farrakhan hooked up with Scientology. Is it even possible that, well, this goes back to the question of, does Scientology even allow for the belief in a single supreme being? Is it possible that Reverend Alfredi Johnson still genuinely believes in his Christian God and still genuinely believes in the technology of Scientology and the amazing man L. Ron Hubbard?
No, they're mutually exclusive concepts.
So do you think he's just not really a believer anymore in Christianity, but just does it because it's great PR for the church?
Mm-hmm.
Truly.
That's what I think.
Truly. What about Louis Farrakhan?
I mean, I don't know. But...
What about Louis Farrakhan? What the hell?
Beats me.
It's a mystery.
It's a total mystery.
Right.
It's a total mystery.
They are not telling him the whole story.
I was just going to say, the one thing that I am certain about is Louis Farrakhan or any of his people don't get the whole picture.
Right.
They've got a bit, and it's being fed to them in a fashion that makes it acceptable, and somehow they can absorb it and use these little workable pieces of Scientology. Unless they have abandoned their Black Muslim religion or beliefs, they can't possibly be all in for Scientology.
It's true.
Because you can't have both.
Right.
You can't be both. You have to be one or the other.
Right.
And so they're not really Scientologists, but it's that difficult thing. So when is someone a Scientologist? When they're using the materials of L. Ron Hubbard, because that makes them a Scientologist just like anybody else. Well, that's probably true by that definition. And eventually, if they stick with it, they're going to find out that this ain't gonna work,
right?
Because you can't be a real Scientologist,
right,
without disowning and I don't know even what the word is. I like disagreeing that there is anything other than Scientology as the route to spiritual freedom and spiritual enlightenment and clearing the planet and making a good society and having happy people and having a job and making a lot of money and what I like everything and anything across the entire gamut of life.
Right. You know, I think David Miscavige, and jump in because you'd probably know better than I think he thought it was some huge success, this relationship with the Nation of Islam, because somehow he thought that was going to open the doors for Scientology into Black America. And what's laughable about that is that he would assume that Black America in any way has some fundamental identification with the Nation of Islam.
Yeah, well, I can make a bad joke, but I'm not sure that it's appropriate.
I mean, you have mentioned before that the whole, you know, Dougie Fresh, who's an old time, one of the original hip hop stars, or rap stars, Dougie Fresh and Isaac Hayes were the ones who, through their sort of polite complaints why there were no Black people in Scientology, is what got David Miscavige to be like, okay, we are going to just full-blown buy and set up an org in Harlem. We're going to do it in Inglewood. We're going to try to break into Black America. But is there any truth, is there any relationship to the complaints that, that Dougie Fresh and Isaac Hayes would have made? And this relationship with Louis Farrakhan, or are these two completely, these were two different paths?
I honestly don't know, Aaron. I mean, I think Alfredi Johnson was the gateway to the Nation of Islam.
Right.
And I think Alfredi Johnson is out for the good of Alfredi Johnson and all things and everything, and that he saw some opportunity. Who knows what it was,
right,
and ran with it. And because there, I mean, in truth, the DC org, for example, they probably would have closed their doors by now if it hadn't been for NOI people in their taking services.
Right.
I mean,
it's
the only place, Scientology today is getting people from like the Nation of Islam to go on course and getting Sea Org members from Venezuela and rural Russia.
Right.
Because the Nation of Islam people are basically directed by their dictator that this is an acceptable thing for them to do. So they show up to do their Dianetics courses. And the people in Venezuela and rural Russia are seeing this as an opportunity that they can get something that they can't get in their own terrible states of affairs. So, you know, I can see that, that there is some perceived benefit to, you know, if you're in a local Scientology org and you're able to get five people from the Nation of Islam on course somewhere, that's like a big deal for those guys.
Yeah.
I mean, they scramble after every soul that comes in the door. I mean, I was just listening to the latest podcast from, now the name slipped me, Carrie and the guys that went into LA Org and started on course there.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about.
And the every description that they give is the description of like the 10 people hovering around the one poor person that's strayed in the door, and they've caught them like a fly in a spider web, and they circle around them like to make sure they don't get away. It's and that's what life is like in a Church of Scientology. So if you get people from the Nation of Islam, they're going to come and they're going to stay because they're not going back to report into whatever the boss in the Nation of Islam is. Oh no, we didn't finish the course.
Right.
If they're told that that's what they're supposed to do, they go do it.
Right.
So they're perfect as far as Scientology because they're not going to escape.
Such a good point. So let me give my answer to this question. You know, it's funny, about a year ago, I was involved in a conversation. It was with several people, and my mom was included. And She said something to the effect of, in her whole time in Scientology, she'd never relinquished her either belief or thought or that the possibility that there was a supreme being. And at the time, I said she was lying. I called bullshit. And, you know, I've spent a lot of time since then thinking about, like, how could that be true? Like, in what way could it be possible that someone could be in Scientology for, you know, 30 years or whatever and still believe in a supreme being? And I guess based on some of the things that you've said, it's possible. You never sat down and told you can't believe in God. And actually what we might want to differentiate here is the difference between believing in Jesus as the Savior or any prophets or anything. There's definitely material in Scientology that says, like, Jesus is not real, that kind of stuff.
Right.
But I'm not aware of anything that specifically says God is
not
real.
No, there is nothing.
But so let me explain why growing up in Scientology, it never occurred to me in a million years that there could be a God. People who believe in God, there's a dynamic there of somewhat of a subservience. If God exists, then he has a plan. People differ in their beliefs on just how much he micromanages that plan, or whether you should try...
Fourth quarter touchdown.
Or whether, because there is a God, you should even try to direct the course of your life. There's different
right.
beliefs in that. But there's still at least some level of belief. And in Scientology, there is no quarter given whatsoever to some external influence having any impact on your life. It's you. It's you. It's always been you. It'll always be you. And, you know, there's something in Scientology called, is it the axioms that says in the beginning there was a decision? No, it's not the, is it the axioms?
Factors.
The factors. I should know that. There's these like, I think there's 10 factors, maybe there's 12, it's something like that. That's sort of Scientology's true spiritual origin story. And it's not really a story, it's just 10 items. You know, in the beginning there was a decision, and the decision was to be. That was like the first factor, right?
Right.
Now someone could say, well, that decision could have been God. And you go, no, not the way the factors are written. That decision was Thetans. Collectively, whether a single unit or a multi-unit, you never really know because it's never really dictated.
Right.
But if there's a God, okay. In Scientology, it is believed, it is taught that Thetans, collectively, Theta, created the physical universe.
Correct.
But if there's a God, then God created Thetans. And Scientology never says that. It's kind of an important step. Either God created Thetans or he didn't. The way the factors are written is kind of like, no, Theta just sort of spontaneously decided to exist one day. Well, that kind of sounds like God, but it's not said that it's God. And if Scientology believed in a God, it would just be said. God created Theta.
Right.
Okay, so I guess the most important part of that answer is, to me, growing up, I always felt that anyone who believed in God also believed that God had some sort of effect on them, and Scientology does not allow for there to be a God that has an effect on you, so therefore, by extrapolation, there is no God. And that's why I was just so...
You are far too logical.
How did I stand for so long? okay, so that's my answer. Now, we have other questions that we can either discuss now or we can discuss later, but I want to skip these questions and talk about the subject of OT levels.
Can we can't discuss them now. We have to discuss them
later. We can, but we won't.
Oh.
Okay, so here's why I want to discuss this. It kind of has so much to do with why I even started the channel, or what message I even have, what message I'm even trying to get across in this the big picture to people who are still in Scientology. It has to do with why I finally made the jump emotionally and logically to being like, oh yeah, Scientology really is bullshit. And what I'm talking about is whether there are any other OT levels that L. Ron Hubbard researched, wrote up, and left behind that are waiting to be released. This is so important because, you know, in Scientology, the ultimate thing everyone's trying to achieve is the state of full operating Thetan. So Thetan is just who you are as a spirit. Operating just means, let's just give it a definition here, regaining your godlike state, okay? Scientology believes that Thetans are natively godlike and that we've fallen a long ways down to the point where we're now trapped in bodies and we don't remember anything prior to this life. We can no longer control the physical universe just with our thoughts. So operating in operating Thetan means having fully regained your godlike powers.
Right.
And full just means full. You've full.
Complete.
Complete. So currently in Scientology, there are 8 OT levels that have been released. And these are just auditing levels that you do. If Scientologists have not done the OT levels, they have no idea what's on them. Scientologists believe that the OT levels and doing them is what is going to bring them fully back to a godlike state. It's what they believe L. Ron Hubbard accomplished before he died, and it's what they believe they will do themselves once these levels are released.
Right.
Now, for me, I told a story. Anyone watching this video, please watch another video on this channel called The Matrix, Fundamentalist Scientology, and Enforced Disconnection. Please watch that video. It's about 33 minutes long. There's a story I tell at the end of the video where I sort of explain to a whole bunch of other people I knew in the church, like, you know, look, Scientology helped me in many, many ways. I don't harbor any ill will towards Scientology or Scientologists. I've got no problem with people doing Scientology. Do it. Who cares? But when you're being forced to disconnect from your family due to some perceived transgressions, and you're having it hammered into your head that Scientology is more important than your family because Scientology can get you to full OT, and that's your only chance for salvation as a spirit for the rest of trillennia, you need to know that there are no more OT levels. It's a fucking lie. It's a lie that unfortunately started with LRH. It was continued by Pat Broker, and then after that by David Miscavige. And the fact that this lie has been perpetuated to control Scientologists is, for me, the one thing that makes me comfortable going, it's all bullshit. It might have helped me in many ways, but something doesn't have to be true in order to be helpful. You know, like if we sit here and for the sake of academic discussion say there is no God, it doesn't mean that people aren't helped by their belief in God. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Whether that's true or not, that doesn't change
it's
the fact that
debate.
They may or may not be helped.
Exactly. And I don't believe in going to someone who feels they have been helped and trying to insist that they have not.
Yeah.
Like, that doesn't ring.
I agree.
So in that video, I tell a story that basically my understanding, the first revelation for me that there were no more OT levels came from someone I truly believed would know. And I trusted him. And that was Dan Kuhn. And please watch the video because it'll explain what I'm talking about a little better. Because you've been in Scientology for so long, because you knew LRH, because you've known Dan Kuhn for decades, because you've known David Miscavige for decades, I would love to hear your take on whether you believe there are more OT levels, why you believe that, what you know, what facts you know pertaining to this, and who in Scientology would be, like, who are the people who know for sure? Because there's a lot of people in management who, no matter how long they were there, would probably say, I don't know one way or the other. That's above my pay grade. There might be some people who would feel that, no matter how much time they spend at international management.
Right.
So who are the people for which it's not above their pay grade? And were you one of those people? And I've probably asked you like 20 questions now. So just talk for a little bit, and then I'll give you some follow-ups.
Okay. There are no OT levels above OT8. Mm-hmm. And the reason that I have certainty about that is some deductive reasoning and some facts. The facts are that I have heard the person who does know and always should have known and was the one who was, if there was anybody in Scientology responsible for the release of those OT levels after Hubbard died, it was the senior CS International, Ray Medoff. And Ray Medoff was with L. Ron Hubbard just before he died and received whatever final instructions he had for what should be done now that he was moving off to Target 2.
Before you continue, what does CS mean?
Case supervisor. That's the person who oversees the auditing, which is Scientology counseling.
Good.
And he oversees auditors.
So the senior case supervisor international is the one person who is ultimately responsible for supervising all auditing in the entire world.
Correct.
And you said going off to target two. Target two is what?
Target two is this concept that Hubbard came up with of, you know, once we're done with handling planet Earth, we'll move on to target two, which is starting to confront dealing with the entire universe.
And the target two is basically just the second planet.
Yeah, or something akin to that.
Okay.
Something otherworldly. There you go.
Somewhere other than Earth.
Somewhere other than Earth.
And that's Alarache's explanation for why he didn't come back to pick up another body here on Earth, is he had to go off and start Scientology on Target 2.
Yeah, sort of.
We'll
I
get
guess.
Into but
you know, but yeah, I guess
to most Scientologists, that's what they think.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, that'd be a fair.
Okay, I mean, so I interrupted you.
All of this is bullshit anyway, so it doesn't really matter. But Ray Mitoff is the person who was not only responsible for that function being performed of releasing these additional OT levels, he was also the person who had the last communications with L. Ron Hubbard about the subject.
Verbally? Now,
there were four people that were there. There was Pat Broker, Annie Broker, Sarge.
Okay.
And Ray.
Okay.
That was it. And Annie Broker is dead. And I'm going to get to Sarge's recounting of the events. Mm-hmm. Pat Broker hasn't spoken.
Ah! Go ahead.
Pat Broker, Annie Broker, Sarge, and Ray Mitoff. Annie Broker's dead. Pat Broker hasn't spoken to anybody for 25 years. I'm going to get to Sarge's recounting of the events. And the most important of all, Ray. Mm-hmm. I have heard David Miscavige berating Ray Mitoff numerous times because Ray Mitoff, quote, can't remember what the OT levels are, that he forgot.
I mean, half the Scientologists in the world watching this video just fainted.
He can't remember. He's not sure if it's supposed to be this, or he's not sure if it's supposed to be that. Can you believe this guy? He doesn't even know. This is Miscavige at Ray Mitoff. The story about how all of these materials were written up by Hubbard and they're all waiting and, you know, they're available for, you know, release once management has determined that they will be released, it's all horseshit. Because the second fact is that after L. Ron Hubbard died, Pat Broker went off, took himself away, and there was this power struggle between, it's a long story, but the power struggle between him and David Miscavige as to who was ultimately going to control Scientology in the wake of L. Ron Hubbard's departure. And Pat Broker had a leg up, which was he had been, at least some of the time, with Hubbard in his last years.
And David Miscavige was
and
not.
And David Miscavige had never been with him. But David Miscavige was the relay point from Hubbard to all Scientology in the outside world. And so he had, and Miscavige had other things. He had all the lawyers, he had a lot of people that supported him, etc., etc. But in any event, Pat Broker disappeared to another ranch. Hubbard lived on a ranch called in Creston, or near Creston, you know, north of Santa Barbara. There was another ranch called in a place called Newberry Springs, which is the it's like near Boron. It's out in the desert between LA and Vegas. Like, this place is like meth central. And there was this ranch out there, and there were some people that were there, including John Brousseau, as a matter of fact. John Brousseau was like the ranch hand out there. Hubbard was never there, but it was like a staging area.
It was a horse place, right?
Sort of, yeah.
Okay.
Anyway, Pat Broker took, in theory, all of these materials and was refusing to turn them over. And so there was this nighttime raid that was arranged of the Newberry Springs property. And me and a bunch of other people, Greg Wilhair, and I can't even remember who else, showed up there.
Was Marty there too?
Marty.
Was David Miscavige personally there too?
Bill Dendu. Miscavige was there with Monique Yingling and...
Monique Yingling was involved that long ago.
Yep.
Wow.
And the place was, and you know, I was there and there was like six PIs and we had shotguns and it was like literally a raid.
On this property, on this ranch.
Okay. And everything was taken. Every piece of paper that was on there, the file cabinets, the trucks that had been buried, literally, Pat Broca had, if he thought that security had been compromised, he had a bulldozer on the property, he dug a hole, and he drove the vehicle into the hole and covered it up with dirt. Get rid of the vehicle. They were all pulled out of the ground. Everything was taken. Everything was taken.
The purpose of this raid was what?
To get the materials.
Because
Pat was saying they existed.
He's saying, I've got them.
I've got them.
You can't have them.
You can't have
them.
This
is how I'm going to retain power.
Exactly.
Okay.
And Ray couldn't remember. So Miscavige's only way of getting this stuff was to now do this raid.
He's trying to steal these materials from
Pat Broca.
Trying to
get the materials. Yeah. Okay. He doesn't think he's stealing them. He thinks he's regaining them to their rightful owner.
Right.
The church.
Right, right.
You know. And that resulted in a big, fat goose egg of nothingness.
So then it
became more Ray has to remember. Okay, so that's a part of it. The next part is the recounting of the last days of L. Ron Hubbard by Sarge. Steve Falf is his real name, but everybody knew him as Sarge. And I've known this guy for a very, very long time. And he was like L. Ron Hubbard's little handyman. And he is the most mild-mannered, sweetest guy, and was absolutely devoted to L. Ron Hubbard. I mean, he was like devoted to him. And
would you say he still is?
I would say he still is.
So he's not some L. Ron Hubbard hater?
No. Sarge is like the biggest fan of what a great man L. Ron Hubbard was that you could find walking on planet Earth.
Okay.
Believe me. And he ultimately told the story after much soul searching and a lot of tears and emotion about telling this story about the final days of L. Ron Hubbard, still looking for BTs and sending him...
Let's define it.
Body Thetans, which is those entities that you deal with on the OT, on some of the OT levels.
Any Scientologist who has done OT-8 would know that all of the Body Thetans are supposed to be handled on OT-7. If you're still handling Body Thetans, you've not gotten past OT-7.
Correct.
Okay.
And that Hubbard was obsessed with these Body Thetans, and he was sending Sarge to go find them, and then had Sarge build an E-meter to electrocute his body effectively to commit suicide by blowing all of these BTs away from his body with electrical currents. Now, this is beyond bizarre. This is lunatic asylum material, particularly when you have any familiarity with Scientology's belief about electric shock and the use of electric shock in controlling people and creating bad experiences and whatever. I'm not even going to get into all of the stuff that's contained in a lot of the writings of Hubbard about how electric shock is used to control Thetans.
Sure.
But it is, and it's considered to be very bad, and this story I know is, or I believe, I don't know because I wasn't there, but I believe that what Sarge said really did happen, because it broke his heart to tell the story. I mean, like broke him to recount what had happened. But he had this sort of inside him and nobody to talk to, and so he recounted that story.
And then, even when he recounts the story, he's not saying, let me tell you how LRH was really a liar. He's saying, let me just tell you what happened.
How serious it was, and, you know, and, like, and, you know, and his, from his perspective, how terrible it was that he couldn't help.
Right.
And then there is the simple fact that since L. Ron Hubbard said originally in 1978 or whenever it was, oh, there are OT levels above all the way to OT-15 or something, and that these will bring you to states never before believed and contemplated and blah, 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 blah. That is a long time. That is nearly 40 years. And if it's true, or if it were true, that David Miscavige and the Church of Scientology held within its grasp the golden balls that were the answer to all man's spiritual freedom, and they haven't made it available to anybody, then they are completely and utterly contradicting everything that they say they stand for. Like, you can't say that as that Scientology has all the answers, that we are the only people that can save planet Earth, that we are the people who have the true path to spiritual enlightenment, that we are, of all people on Earth, we are the group and the organization that has the highest ethical levels and the most moral and compassionate perspective and are selfless in our devotion toward the accomplishment of happiness for all, every man, woman, and child on Earth, and have this stuff and not make it available, particularly when that stuff would make them a lot of money. I mean, if you want to get down to the really base argument that explains and is irrefutable that they don't exist, is they haven't been made available, and if they did, they could make a lot of money out of them. Mm-hmm. Because by necessity, people who have made it all the way to OT-8 in Scientology have money. You gotta have it to get there. They've got plenty more of it. Mm-hmm. Right now, they're trying to suck it out of them for the IES and for ideal orgs and this and that. And that becomes an increasingly difficult task.
Right.
If they released OT 9 and 10, those people would pay anything for it.
That's right.
Literally anything. They, if they said it was $1 million a level, they'd go, oh, cool. And the more they charge for it, the great, the more wonderful the success stories would be afterwards. And what I have never been able to understand, Aaron, is why, and you know, Miscavige got himself into a bit of a problem because he originally announced, well, we can only release, according to instructions from Ron Hubbard, we can only release OT 9 and 10 when all orgs are the size of Old St. Hill, mm-hmm. which was just, he just made that up. He wanted people to take responsibility for the orgs because at the time they were the income source, etc., etc. So he figured he'd get all the OT8s joining staff and engaged in helping their local org. Mm. Well, when that didn't work out, it became the ideal org program because we'll just get money from them. Instead of asking them to join staff, it's easier to get them to give money. So we'll just make a bunch of money. So when all orgs are ideal, then OT 9 and 10 will be released. Mm-hmm. Well, the way that it's going, that's never. That will literally be never. But sooner or later, he confronts the problem of people are getting, they're dying. They're getting old and dying without OT 9 and 10, and they've done the prerequisites for it 10 years ago. They probably even paid deposits for it. There's these people that are waiting and waiting and waiting. I don't know why he just doesn't invent some shit and put it out and right. say, this is it, you know? One of those old OT levels, or one of the things from creation of human. That's been my prediction for a long time, that eventually this is what would have to happen. And then he's going to say, see, there really is an OT 9 and 10.
Right.
And the people that do it will all go, oh man, this is the greatest thing. Unbelievable how this, and not even realize that it was in creation of human ability right. or some tape lecture from back then. And you'll get the same sort of success stories and idiotic, I'm now the master of the universe that people are giving from running around the pole right. in the Fort Harrison.
So there never was any policy from L. Ron Hubbard that says all orgs have to reach a certain size before OT 9 and 10 can be released?
No. There was a statement once somewhere that says these things will be released when management determines it's appropriate, or something like that. But you realize that this having a carrot that is beyond what currently exists is the patent of Scientology from 1950.
Right.
There is nothing new about this. There's always something that's coming that now will solve the thing that you thought was going to be solved up to this point but didn't really get solved.
Right.
You can go all the way back to Dianetics
right.
and then all the processes in Scientology and then the grades and then it was power. Oh, and then it's R6CW. And then, it's the clearing course. And then, it's OT3. It's OT4. It's been that pattern all along.
So it's funny, again, the reason this OT 9 and 10 thing is so important is because one of the biggest glaring red flags in Scientology that gets rationalized away by all Scientologists is the fact that these OT levels that are supposed to save every soul in this frickin' universe have not been, no additional OT levels have been released for, is it 25 years? And that's why I asked this thing about, so there really was no policy from LRH. The last release was like 86, right? So 30 years.
Yeah.
The one thing Scientologists think is the answer for why these OT levels have not been released is because David Miscavige has been telling them for 30 years that L. Ron Hubbard said it would not be safe to release these OT levels. They're so powerful. It would not be safe to put these OT levels into the hands of human beings until Scientology has achieved a certain level of control over the world, and that control will have been accomplished once all orgs, and at that time, there's fewer orgs now than there were then, but all orgs in the world had to reach a certain size, which was approximately 200 staff members, approximately $200,000 worth of income a week, approximately a certain number of new people being gotten into Scientology every week. For 30 years, David Miscavige has been telling the world of Scientology that L. Ron Hubbard said these OT levels could not be released until the world was calmed down enough. And that would be accomplished when these orgs were big enough. And that simple explanation is what keeps people in fucking Scientology.
I never even heard that explanation.
Well, I'm glad I could be of help.
But the concept that one org with 200 people in New York is going to make any difference is so absurd. There's two orgs in Russia.
Right.
There's none in the Middle East.
Half of the states in the United States don't have a single Scientology organization. Maybe less than half.
So
entire middle of America has like four or five organizations.
So there is further proof of just this whole thing is illogic built on a logic built on a logic.
Right. Let me throw in another anecdote on how important this concept is and why I really, it's probably not even the only video we're going to discuss it in. when I was in the Sea Org, so I was from 22 years old to 26 years old. I was on staff for a long time, but I was in the Sea Org from 22 to 26 years old, which was 2002 to 2006. This was right around the time when David Miscavige was starting the Ideal Org program. There were several programs that he had started in motion. And even if the public didn't know about them yet, we had received letters from David Miscavige that were read aloud at meetings that detailed these huge, broad, sweeping changes to Scientology, like completely revamping all of the technical aspects of Scientology a second time, completely revamping all administrative aspects of Scientology. And David Miscavige, in the events that Scientology holds, he kept using this word, orders of magnitude. New orders of magnitude, a whole new order of magnitude. He kept using it. And the OT levels each have names. And I forget which, either OT9 or OT10 is called orders of magnitude.
Yeah, one's character and one's orders of magnitude,
that's
right?
That's right. And just so you know, I don't want to get into too many digressions here, but the reason you hear OT9 and 10 spoken about together is the same reason you hear OT6 and 7 spoken about together. OT6 is really a course where you learn how to audit OT7, and OT9, if what I'm told is correct, OT9 is supposed to be the course where you learn to audit OT10. Now, apparently they were telling us low-level people shit that you guys were never told, but maybe because they didn't need to tell you guys that stuff, right? Okay, so we absolutely, I'm going to say we're led to believe and allowed to believe that the reason David Miscavige was able to come up with all these new sweeping strategies that apparently had never occurred to L. Ron Hubbard were necessary were because he and his fellow executives at International Management were doing OT 9 and 10. I feel like a fucking idiot even saying the words. It is absolutely what we believed. We would get all electrified and excited after events like, holy shit, you guys. They're doing OT 9 and 10. Didn't you get that reference? I mean, I'm so embarrassed to even say it. We were allowed to believe this. There were not people going around saying, don't say such things. You can't create false rumors. Do you know what I mean? And any Scientologist who's done OT8 knows that they are nowhere even close to accomplishing what they have been promised Scientology will provide them. And it is the only thing, I won't say it's the only thing keeping these people in Scientology, right? Because there's other benefits to being in Scientology, and I mean things like there's a huge social networking benefit.
Right.
We can talk about benefits, but then you can also talk about how hard it is to upend your whole life and leave.
Right.
You have to have a really good reason to do that. But I can tell you this, the only thing that allows Scientologists who have done up through OT8, The only thing that would make them disconnect from their family members is this idea that there's all these OT levels that they're just waiting for. If they knew those OT levels didn't exist, and if they believed it, which is why I'm trying to really flesh out additional sources of this information in addition to Dan Kuhn, they would never disconnect from their fucking kids. Ever. They would never let some 16-year-old ethics officer bend them over a fucking barrel and say, you're going to do what I'm going to tell you, because otherwise you're going to get kicked out of the church and you won't get OT 9 and 10. It would never happen.
Right.
Do you agree?
Yes, I do.
it's so amazing that something so fundamentally important as whether OT levels exist or not, or can be so casually explained away as with LRH said we had to do A, B, and C first. And not only that, I know we're kind of talking about this for a long time, but I just think it's important. This whole idea that orgs have to be a certain size, David Miscavige keeps changing the goalposts. Like, that's no longer what he says has to be done.
Right.
Now he says every org has to buy a 50,000 square foot building for $15 to $25 million, including renovations. And once all, that's what he calls an ideal org. We've used that term a few times in this video. These days, an ideal org, the org, even if they only have like 50 public, right, and they're nowhere near capacity on their current building, they have to go buy a brand new 50,000 square foot. They cannot get a mortgage. They have to buy it in cash outright. They have to renovate it. And once every org in the world has finished that, then OT 9 and 10 will be released. And you have to even wonder, though, whether those goalposts is even changing, because he keeps saying Next year we'll release OT 9 and 10. Next year we'll release OT 9 and 10. There's no way all the orgs will be finished with this ideal org program in the next year. So part of me has started to wonder whether a new set of goalposts, whether he's realized he's not going to be able to stick to those goalposts and he's lowering the bar.
Of course.
In order to keep people in the fold.
Of course. If he wanted to release OT 9 and 10,
yeah,
all he has to do, or whatever he's invented to be OT 9 and 10, all he has to do is say, the datum is that once X happens, then, and we just have been arbitrarily operating on this concept, but really it was just a shorthand for having established enough safe places in enough countries to be able to then operate where, you know, who knows? Mm-hmm. Just, he can make up anything he wants.
Right.
And don't believe it.
True. I just want to throw this out as a potential obstacle to coming up with some bullshit OT 9 and 10. LRH has said that the OT levels above 7 and 8 will take longer than the ones below.
Mm-hmm.
Some Scientologists audit themselves on OT 7 for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Some Scientologists can finish in 2 years. It's almost unheard of, but these days it seems like they're allowing people to finish the level faster.
Right.
LRH says that auditing on OT 10 will be exponentially longer than OT 7. Well, on OT 7, when people are auditing themselves, they're basically finding body thetans that are stuck in trapped places and auditing them telepathically and waking them up. And they can do that for like 6 times a day, 10 goddamn years. They have to come up with a process, an auditing process that someone can be convinced is worth doing for 10 years that has something other, that has to do with something other than body thetans. But LRH has never spoken about anything on the OT levels other than body thetans.
I don't know that he has to.
What do you mean?
Well, why doesn't he just come up with something and say, OT 10 is to go and take everybody in your city and audit their body thetans.
That's right. So on OT 7, you're only, I thought on OT 7 you could audit anybody's body
thetans. You can, but you don't have to. Now you have to. Now you have to go and handle everybody else.
Got it. That's brilliant, Mike. That's brilliant, Mike.
I should start my own religion.
You should be chairman of the board. I know there are a lot of Scientologists who watch our videos. And I know there's a lot of Scientologists who are on the fence because you can't ignore the internet. You can't ignore the internet. You can't ignore the deluge of information out there about what a joke Scientology is and has become.
Right.
And it's very hard for Scientologists to cross this line of thinking there might be something wrong with L. Ron Hubbard. The idea that L. Ron Hubbard lied about anything is almost hard for a Scientologist to, like, because once you cross that line, you're almost not a Scientologist anymore.
Correct.
You don't just wake up in the morning looking to not become a Scientologist. Does not wake up in the morning prepared to not be a Scientologist that day. The story that you told of Sarge being asked by LRH to make an e-meter strong enough to electrocute him, blow off his body thetans, and then instantly kill him is enough to immediately make any believer just think that is a destructive evil lie. I mean, getting a Scientologist to believe that story would be like trying to get a Christian to believe there's no God or that Jesus is not the Savior. I mean, it's that order of magnitude, right?
Yeah, Jesus wasn't really nailed to a cross.
Right.
He didn't die for your sins.
Right.
He was just a carpenter.
Right.
And he just, you know, but the problem is that Scientologists are indoctrinated and inculcated into it's funny, into a total black and white world.
Yeah.
Even though, like much else in Scientology, there's a lot of discussion about gradient scales and there's no such, and absolutes are unattainable and it's impossible and blah, blah, blah. But there are a lot of things that are very much a dichotomy in Scientology.
Right.
So, if L. Ron Hubbard, in the minds of a Scientologist, was not truthful here, that cannot be accepted because it cannot go along with, and he did a good thing over here.
Right.
It's all or nothing.
Right.
And there is a lot of Scientology that is all or nothing because it, I mean, we can get into a long philosophical discussion that may be for another time. That is a part of how you keep people from straying, because if you can't stray a little bit, you right. can't stray a lot.
Yep.
So that's kind of the problem, because I don't think that that story of that Sarge tells, or what happened with Hubbard at the end of the of his life, or that he was a, you know, had a very ill body and was not in good shape and was not, you know, the great OT that went up into the sky causatively to move to Target 2. I don't think that that undoes or invalidates some things that he may have done that were good.
Sure.
You can be both good and bad.
Yep.
You can be shades of gray in between, and that's kind of a part of the problem, is they're not allowed to think anything outside of the this is how it is and it is all this way,
right.
and any deviation from that. I mean, this concept of deviating from the taped path and the narrow and the exactly defined and the specific technology, etc., etc., is rife throughout Scientology.
Right. I like what you said. If you can't stray a little, you can't stray a lot. And that's really, really true. So here's an interesting question. We're going to wrap it up pretty soon.
What time is it?
I don't know. We're getting there. It's kind of a long video, but here's the last question. So LRH had said many, many times he'd finished his OT research. It was all written up. It was all compiled. It was all ready to be released when the time came. And yet here you were confronted with a situation where David Miscavige and crew couldn't find the OT levels, and Ray Madoff said he couldn't remember what LRH had said about them. How did you deal with the contradiction that LRH had already said this was already written up, compiled, ready for release, and here's Ray Madoff saying, I never saw them, I don't have them, I don't know where they are, and I can't remember what he said. How did that affect you? How did you reconcile that?
Okay. I didn't reconcile it for long, because I left relatively shortly thereafter, after all that came out or to my attention.
Right.
Because, but whatever. I also looked at Ray and knew that I had been in similar positions of being berated and told, you're an asshole, you don't know this, you don't know that, of things that were like, wait, say that again? What is it I'm supposed to have done? What is it I'm supposed to have said? What is it I'm supposed to know about that now you have decided that I don't? Like, and being incapable of giving an answer to the absurd question that was posed to me, and sort of thinking, that must be what's going on with Ray. It's not really that he can't, it's not exactly
it.
What is being said, it's that's the interpretation of what it is to make him look as bad as possible.
So would it be accurate for me to say, does that mean it's not that you were there while Ray Madoff is saying, I don't remember, it's that David Miscavige is sitting there saying what an asshole Ray Madoff is because he forgot the OT levels, and you're going, well, that's just David Miscavige being an asshole and twisting what actually was said or what actually happened or whatever.
Exactly.
Okay.
That is exactly right. But I now, you know, so much time passes. There never was anything that came, like I said, that was one part of the equation. There's some things that are facts, and then there's some things that are logical conclusions
right.
about here's what's happened.
I get it. In your opinion, is it just an incontrovertible fact that David Miscavige is willfully and intentionally deceiving the entire Scientology population about the existence of these OT levels?
Yes.
Do you feel LRH was doing that as well?
Yes.
Okay. Great. That's what I wanted to discuss on the record, folks. This video is probably way too long. We're probably going to keep it as it is. We have a lot more to come, so stay tuned. Like the video if you liked it, and don't forget to subscribe, and we'll see you soon. Bye.